Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You are welcome in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I want to thank each and every one of you for Tuesday in every way that you contributed to make that day a memorable one. Thank God for your life. Thank God for what God is using each and every one of you to accomplish. Hallelujah. I want us to know and realize that by the special grace of God, we are onto something that is even beyond our imagination. We may just think that, you know, we're just doing outreach or something like that. But if you know how many years it has taken for God to even feel that we are ready for such a work, for Him to approve for us to be doing it, you will understand that it is indeed a great thing that is happening in our midst. Amen. Praise the Lord. I want to believe God that God will use that and many other mediums and platforms that He has given us to effect change and transformation in the kingdom. Amen. I hope you are tuning into our radio program on Dream FM. That's on 6:30 p.m. every Sunday. Praise the Lord. That's another wonderful platform that God has given us to spread His word. I want to thank God for helping us to even be discussing what we are discussing, talking about discerning the body of Christ. And, you know, I remember there was a time we were teaching on unlocking the power of the Spirit. Amen. And one of the things that the Spirit kept on saying that particular time was that we have to earn the right to speak the word. Amen. Earn the right to do certain things in the kingdom. I don't know how many of you remember that. I kept on talking about having to earn that right in order to speak the word and have the Spirit in. You know, carry it out. Amen. And I thank God that how many of you know that the Holy Spirit took us round and round and round and round and round and round. It looked like we will never get there. How many of you know that we have finally gotten there? How many of you realize that? Amen. That we have finally gotten there. We set out, because I remember in one of the teachings, I think Pastor Victor asked that question, and I think Adana also was asked the question, how can we unlock this power? Since we now know that we need this power, how do we unlock it? Hallelujah. How do we earn the right to speak the word? Have power of God in manifestation. And we went round. The Holy Spirit knows how to compare the spiritual with the spiritual. Amen. We kept on comparing the spiritual with the spiritual until we finally got there. But I'm not sure many of you realize that we've gotten there. We've gotten there. But I don't think you realize that we are there already. Because, you know, Paul said to the church at Corinth, he said, I show you a more excellent way. I show you, remember he said, covet the best gifts. Talking about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And then he went on to say, I show you a more excellent way. So we've gotten to that excellent way. That's where we are. We've gotten to that excellent way. This is how to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Because the truth of the matter, I said it a little bit on Tuesday, the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of love. I don't know whether you realize it. Amen. He is the Spirit of love, and all that He distributes is what? Love. All that He distributes is love. So once you make yourself a conduit or a conveyor or a channel of love, you become a conduit, a conveyor, a channel for the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
Are you hearing? It is as automatic as I am saying it. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Now, the more you love, the more the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Because the more you love, the more you create room for Him. Because what He showers is love. The Bible says He sheds forth the love of God abroad in our hearts. So the more you give room for love, the more you give room for the Holy Spirit. If you say you can take more, oh wow. You know, he's always looking for that opportunity. He doesn't miss it. So anytime any man, any woman is open, he comes in. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So when I'm talking about selfishness, I know what I'm talking about. It's hurting you a great deal, but you don't understand it. That's why, think about it. The church today cannot boast of the Holy Spirit like in those early days. It was a common thing for men to be filled with faith and full of the Spirit. Do we have it today? Just ask yourself, do we have such men and women today? We went off track long time ago. And funny enough, we continued in our ignorance and in our stupidity, not relenting, not understanding that we have missed it. When we started valuing the things that we ought not to value, when we started chasing after the things that we ought not to chase after, we started messing ourselves up. Jesus said, no man can love God and no man can serve God and serve mammon. You choose one. You can't serve God and serve mammon. But we think that, it doesn't matter. We can serve mammon and God will be okay with it. You can't. You can't serve God and serve mammon. Why? Because, like I told us on Tuesday, a lot of people are in slavery. Slavery of selfishness. A lot of people are slaves of their selfish loss. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Slaves of your own selfish love. The things that you are lusting after, you become a slave. And so no room for the Holy Spirit. You know, when you say you cannot serve God and mammon. And of course, you know what is behind money. The spirit is that of greed and covetousness. That's the spirit behind money. Greed and covetousness. That's why it's never enough. One yon casino, onye kozu. Hallelujah. He said you cannot serve God and mammon. So when you choose to serve mammon, like many, unfortunately, are serving mammon. In the guise of serving God, but they are serving mammon. Now, how can they be filled with the Spirit? When, like I talked about on Tuesday, when you are busy chasing after, you know, everybody is running after how to make it, how to make it. And I asked the question, and I'm still asking that question. What, is it God that told you that you have to make it? I'm still asking that question. Who ever told us, your parents, who told you now that you have to make it? So everybody is rushing after making it, making it, making it. Everybody is rushing after making it. If you buy a car, you feel you have arrived. You build a house, you feel you have arrived. Have you even sat down to think about it? How stupid you look thinking that because you bought a toy that you have arrived. Just like Chimamanda, you buy electric car now and she will be doing like this. That's how stupid we look. And we feel we are something because some little change has entered our pocket. We now feel important. We now feel privileged. We feel blessed because we have one rubbish. We think that, you know, Onyagozira gozi kambo. Onyagozira gozi kambo. See how stupid we are? Who told you? That's how God blesses his own. Hallelujah. Bible says we have been blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly places. How can a man who is not filled with the Holy Spirit be talking about blessing? But just think about it. How can you open your mouth and say you are blessed and you are not filled with the Holy Spirit and you're talking about blessing? Are you crazy? So it can't be God now because we're talking about the Holy Spirit here. You can see how far we have gone away from God. That's why nobody is interested. Say, all have gone their separate way. None desires after the Lord anymore. We are busy seeking our own thing, seeking after our own stuff, not interested in what the Lord is saying. We're interested in making it, not being filled with the Spirit. Imagine somebody coming to give testimony in church, how that he or she was filled with the Holy Spirit. Would the pastor accept such testimony? Not in those days now, they used to screen testimony. They said, shift. whether it's the evil spirit that is has possessed you, nobody knows. They are coming here to tell us that you have. Nobody who is interested in such a gist. But if you come and tell them, you know, last week Pastor prophesied that God is going to give somebody a car here, and you know, it has happened. Hey, say, stand in front. That's the kind of people we are looking for. Hallelujah. So you can see how far, you know, well, you know, like when I was thinking about being filled with the Holy Spirit, I mean, it didn't look like anything that it looked like it was serious or like it was a big deal, because that's how far we have removed ourselves from God. So when we talk about being filled with the Holy Spirit, nobody really cared. Spirit aposa opohone. Did you hear the Igbo? Spirit aposa opohone. Or spirit kaieli. You don't understand the Igbo. Because I only know what the Igbo kawali adi. How much is the spirit worth? Indication. Or spirit guy. Can you imagine a husband coming home to tell the wife how that the Holy Spirit encountered him and filled him? I would just be saying, looks like this man is going mad. Will that one buy food that we need to eat in their house? So nobody is interested in the Holy Spirit, because they cannot see immediately how he can benefit them. So if he's not going to benefit them in terms of their pocket, in terms of their tummy, in terms of what they need to do to show up, they will not be interested. But if you can relate the Holy Spirit to money, to house, to car, to, you know, the things that the men value, now we can understand your Holy Spirit, the Spirit that we want, that Spirit, you know. They said to Jesus, you know, evermore give us this bread. He said, the bread I'm talking about is not that one you eat. This time around, I'm talking about my flesh that a man will eat and not die. So look at this fellow. Do you think we are barbarians? Because when he was telling them about the bread that a man will eat and not die, and also the drink you will drink, and hey, they remember the bread they ate yesterday. God have mercy. Remember that time people were lining up to buy bread at the shop, right? And then suddenly somebody comes there and say, there's one better than this one. And then people will be arguing, is it possible that there will be a bread better than this one that we are lining up for? They say, okay, let's go and see now. And then he said, the bread is my flesh that you now. How does that relate to the shop, right, bread? That will not even, I remember those days when we buy it in the house here. It wouldn't even last that night, even if it's too loose. By the time the children press it like, yeah. He said, will this bread that you're talking about, will it be better than the one we ate yesterday? Hallelujah. So the truth of the matter is that this is how far we have been removed from reality, the reality of the Spirit, of the things of God. And we have moved deep into the things of the flesh. That's why it's rare in our time to hear that someone is filled with the Holy Spirit. Because it's not an experience that we are common, that is common with us. It's not common with our generation. This is the thing. Hallelujah. If you're a woman, a man who is ready to love, then you are ready for the Holy Spirit. Amen. You know, I show you a more excellent way. You want to be filled with the Spirit? This is how to be filled with the Spirit. Doesn't take no magical anything. Are you hearing what I'm saying? That's how to be filled with the Spirit of God. Once your heart is an expressway for the Spirit, and the Spirit never misses that kind of opportunity, doesn't lose it. That's why the Bible says he distributes his gifts as he will. Once he sees, that's why he said, I show you a more excellent way. Now, what he's trying to tell you is that with that love, you can never misfire. Now, if you're seeking for the gifts of the Spirit, he said, with that love, you can. Now, the Holy Spirit, in other words, he's telling you that the Holy Spirit can never overlook you. Now, he's a sure banker. Now, are you hearing what I'm saying? He's a sure banker. The Holy Spirit would never over. That's why he said, I show you a more excellent way. A way that is better than coveting, than coveting, yes. Instead of coveting, you know what you need to do? Just have that love. And he went on in 1 Corinthians 13 to discuss what that love is all about. Amen. Praise the Lord. So this is what the Holy Spirit is. Now, you can't imagine someone that is thinking, working, and living for the body of Christ. How will the Holy Spirit not fill you up? No, just tell me how. In living, working, thinking about the body of Christ. How will the Holy Spirit not fill you? Just tell me how possible it is for the Holy Spirit not to fill you. You can't miss the attention of the Holy Spirit because he thrives wherever there is love. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And the more you love, the more he showers you with love. And the Bible talks about faith that worketh by what? Love. So that's the easiest way to grow in faith and to grow in the spirit and be a matured Christian. Hallelujah. So you see, you have a lot to gain than to lose. That's why he said, they that are led by the Spirit of God are what? The sons of God. So I wonder why do we read the Bible and we never really give a thought and we never really want what we're reading to be a part of us? He said, they that are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. So if you're not led by the Spirit of God, who are you? You're not a son. Then who are you? Huh? You don't want to say. Short of, mommy said, son of the world. Short of saying, son of Satan. Pastor, the same thing. So it's either God or the devil. That's the way. There's no middle ground. Yeah. So, but you know, it's a reality. You see, they that are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. So why is it that is not a priority? Why do you think that should not be a priority for a believer? Why should it be other things that will be more important in the life of a believer than being led by the Spirit or being filled with the Spirit? What has happened to our senses? Hallelujah. You see, when I talk about how that we have become slaves to the elements of this world because of the things that we love, that's what has happened. We have become slaves to the elements of the world. We don't even have feelings again. We don't even have conscience. We are just like I don't know what I will call. You know, we just follow these things like flies. That's why when you have understanding of this thing, you put them. Bible says, make use of the world without abusing it. Are you hearing what I'm saying? We make use of the world. Whatever the world has to offer, we do what? We make use of it. We don't have any value for it. Those things don't define our lives. That's what makes us believers. That's what separates us from unbelievers. When we allow things to define us, we are not different from unbelievers. Are you hearing what I'm saying? What makes us believers is that things don't define us. We make use of things. Doesn't matter whether it's a Bugatti. Doesn't matter whatever Rolls Royce. It is what? Things. It won't change from vanity because it's Rolls Royce. What's Rolls Royce? It's for the people of the world to be feeling whatever they are feeling about those things. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Now, the things of the world should not be giving you goosebumps. You know what they call goosebumps? Batoi. You know, chop your school fees. She got it. Batoi. The things of this world should not be giving you goosebumps. And you shouldn't feel anyhow because you have it. Are you getting what I'm saying? You shouldn't feel anyhow. And like I always say, the problem that God has with most of us is that he can't trust us. Because young week up need Jesus and not be those things. And then he mistakenly lands some cash your way. Hey! Praise the Lord. Omeliho Jibuluchi Jehovah. You know, and off you go. He can't trust you. That's the problem. Okoma. You know, in those days, you move like this. Adoyan also. He can't trust you. That's the thing. Can't trust you. Now, just imagine Jesus. Somebody will carry Bugatti Veyron and Jesus will feel anything. Just imagine. Or you bring iPhone X. Hey, iPhone X. Hey, iPhone. Just imagine Jesus doing that. That's how lost we are.
The things that mock you, they are the things you are celebrating.
How? It's not madness. How do you celebrate what mocks you?
You know, that's it. These are the things the devil is making for being born.
Because you don't even know what you lost in the garden. You don't even know. Some Christians are even thinking that when they get to heaven, these useless things that they are seeing here, that's what they...
Because will be paved with gold. And you don't even understand. So how will God even begin to even trust you? Or even because what are they handing? You are teaming up with the devil to celebrate the things, the stuffs that mock your fall. Because if not that you fell in the garden, you wouldn't need this thing. You wouldn't need them.
Huh?
Our covering was never meant to be paper, clothing, all these things.
No.
It was supposed to be the glory of God that should be covering us. But we replace the glory of God with Gucci and Da Vinci and all the rest of them. And somebody, because he or she doesn't have money to buy Gucci, but because the only money you have can afford bend down, you are feeling that God has cheated you. God, if you going to him, bend down cannot see.
Even that alone,
from the book of life. That's why he said, we make use of this thing without abusing it. So let them that possess live as though they possess not. These things are nothing, absolutely nothing. And that's where you should place it. You have it good. You don't have it good. Doesn't change anything. I can do all things through Christ that strengthened me. I know how to abase and how to suffer need. These are not, these absolutely not, doesn't mean anything. We are there who do not have confidence in the flesh, but rejoice in the spirit. You know, this is the consequence of the absence of the spirit. Because if you had the spirit, it wouldn't matter if you had anything in your pocket. Your joy will still be full. Hallelujah. Because if you have the spirit, you have everything. He's the one that gave birth to this world. Don't allow the enemy to, you know, it's a warped mentality. It's a warped mind for you to allow the enemy to use the things of this world to make you to begin to feel somehow. That means you have not gotten the message. You've not gotten the message. That's when they say you are a man of faith. A man of faith is a man who can see tomorrow, who sees in the spirit. He said, whilst we look not at that which is seen, for that which is seen is what? Temporal. But that which is unseen is eternal. So you are a man of faith because you can see beyond the natural, beyond the normal. Hallelujah. So the things that excite men don't excite you. Hallelujah. I went for a function the other day, and I was seeing all the running around, and I was just laughing inside of me. I mean, that is, you could just see literally that men worship money. All that all that works operates in their mind is money, money, money. So if they feel that you have money, you will see everybody will be falling for you. Money, you know, it's the money that they are falling for. This is the problem with our world. You can't be caught up with that. Are you hearing what I'm saying? That's how much we belittle ourselves. And you know, like I keep saying, God will allow, you know, whatever situation or circumstance around you, God uses it to test, to know, to gauge your faith, to know how you have grown in his things. He uses the circumstances, the situation, you know. Somebody receives 20 naira. That's not a testimony. Not something to give praise about. That's one of those things, you know. But let that 20 naira change to 20 million. He wants to give testimony. He wants to give testimony. How that God blessed him with 20 million. He has forgotten how many times 20 naira has fallen into his hands. But that one is not blessing. But because the 20 naira suddenly became 20 million, he's now doing pastor. I want to test. Is it how warped we are in our minds? What's the difference between 20 million and 20 naira? Because you have checked what 20 naira will do and what 20 million naira will do. What are you checking on? Is it not based on the value you have for things?
This is the value.
Now imagine Jesus. What would the 20 naira and 20 million naira mean to him? Imagine somebody in the hospital with his leg hanging, and the doctors have told him he may not live for another 5 or 6 days, and they told him somebody paid 20 million naira into his account. His face will just be like this. Did you hear what I said? He doesn't know what you're talking about. At that point in time, he doesn't, whether he has 1 billion in his account, does it matter? You know, is the our, you know, I want you to understand that that's the game the enemy plays with you. He conditions, he gets your mind to work according to your circumstances and situations. That he reduces your mind to your present, your situation, your circumstances, and your mind is hovering around them. You will never see God. You will never see God until you rise above the circumstances, until you rise above the situation. You will never see God. That's until you begin to think from where God thinks. And that will make you to discountenance. That's discountenance things. So if you discountenance them, they won't disturb you again. You will have freedom to appreciate God, appreciate who He is, appreciate His Spirit. And then you can have what is called fellowship with God. A fellowship that is without any interference of anything whatsoever. Because at that point, nothing means anything to you. That's why I said, whatsoever is born of God has overcome the world. Because you know the game. You understand the game. You understand what is at stake. The devil cannot be doing you. The more you look, the less you see. Yeah? And that's why, you know, that sometimes, you are full of anxiety. You are fidgeting. You put in a bill or contract. Holy Ghost. Touch him. Touch them. Fire. Touch them to give you what? What are they giving you? What are they giving? The problem is the posture. The posture. You wonder, have you ever wondered why is it that these people, they love giving big men jobs? They'll give them another one. Why do you think that they love giving big men? Because of he's a big man, or because no, ogogo. The problem is that even that your fear and anxiety, you wouldn't even know. You carry it into the office and they are looking at you. They say, this one, if we give him the money, he will run. He said, if we give him the money, he will run. Eh? Let's give that big man. He saw that chief with his jeep. That one is not going anywhere. They will give him again. I wonder. I said, oh, go bribe. Stand there. When the anxiety is written all over you, you think if it's me, I will give you. I will not give you because you will run with the money. You look too desperate. You look too desperate, man. Even God self will not even. He said, this one, get chukwa mafa here. Oh, I love Takam here. The kingdom, the name of the kingdom will be battered. The anxiety, you know, it's the value, lose value for these things. So you will see that it is nothing. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You lose value. I remember a long time ago when I used to go for work around the neighborhood. I would be, as I'm going, you know, I'll be looking at houses like this. I'll be looking at this one. The Lord just kept quiet, didn't talk. I did this thing for about 2 weeks. One day I was just looking. He said, what are you even looking at? I see these houses are fine. And he said, they are fine. So that's, you have value for these things. And you know what was going on in my mind was like, that was actually what was going on until he scolded me. Will you remove that rubbish thought from your mind? He said, what is this thing? It's nothing. Lose the value. Because as long as you have value for it, because I know that you love me, I will never allow you to have it. I will never allow you to. So the problem, you are the one holding yourself. The value is too much. If he allows you, if he puts it into your hands now, he will lose you. That's the problem. He will lose you. Lose value. They are nothing. He said, all things are yours. Value. Praise the Lord. I was reading something about Bill Gates the other day. They were interviewing him and they said he had already given $40 billion of his money to charity. $40 billion of his money has already gone into charity. Huh? He was in Nigeria the other day, Dangote's daughter's wedding. If not that people know him as Bill Gates, you see him on the road, you will pass him. $40 billion he has already spent on charity. You can see why even God allowed the money to come into his hands. If it was you, would you spend that kind of money on charity? You would have built an island. You would have built an island with the money. And then maybe, I don't know, all those things, I mean, they don't mean anything. Hallelujah. And when you hear him talk, you wonder, all these are our GOs. They need to learn. Our GOs, they need to. $40 billion. Not even sure he owns a private jet. Not sure that he owns one. Those kind of people, they don't spend money like that.
Praise the Lord.
I'm talking about unbeliever because he doesn't even understand half of the things we are talking about.
Yet look at what he's doing.
If he has any idea of what we're talking about, God have mercy.
God have mercy.
If he has any idea of what we're talking about. He was sharing. He said that before his foundation started their work, that infant mortality was around 10 million every year in the world all over. He said because of the work they've been doing all over the world, that the mortality rate has been reduced to like 5 million. And he said he's still working very hard to bring down that number. He's all over the world pumping money into research, into polio, malaria, things that he has no business doing to save lives all over the world. And I said, we just started talking about love. We have a long journey. We have a long way to go. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I wanted to realize that when God said, love your neighbor as yourself, that instruction is heavy. Are you hearing what I'm saying? That instruction is heavy. And I just pray that God will continue to help us. Remember, like I said, I love what Bill Gates is doing. But you know, that's just what he's doing for the passion and the love that he has for poor and, you know, poor people in the world. He has a passion for them. But humanity, so to say, right? But that's not, the kingdom of God is not about humanity. I hope you know. So it's about the body of Christ. The body of Christ. If only he could, it won't stop him from what he's doing. I hope you know. If he could have that understanding of the body of Christ, I'm sure that God will use him to do a whole lot more. And then that he's, you know, the Bible says, even if you give all that you have to the poor and you don't have love, it's nothing. Doesn't mean anything. It's not counted. Hallelujah. So it's not really about giving stuff. It's much, much, much more than that. Much, much, much more than that. But you know, some men like that, when you hear their stories, when you see what they are doing, though I've not had a one-on-one conversation with them, it looks to me like they have understanding of some of these things that we are talking about. Because what will make a man to spend $40 billion of his money on just helping people must be extraordinary. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Must be extraordinary. Not that he understands what we are talking about, yet he could do that. Of course, I've told you that he's one of the billionaires in the world who have, in fact, he was the one who led that I don't know what they call themselves. They said they were not going to leave anything for their children. I've told you that before. Yes. He's one of the people championing that with Warren Buffett. Many of them, they said they are not going to leave anything for their children. Doesn't it mean that, or doesn't it show that they have already understood that these things are vanity? Because if not, they would have been thinking about how to set up their children to take over from them. Yes. You know, like those preachers of those days will be telling you how the Lord will set you up to build generations of, bring fortunes for generations to come. And in those days, we were buying into it. He said, the word that God is talking about is not just you. He's talking about generations. Generation, children. So he's going to give you money that your children will be eating. And we were there jumping up like a whoosh. Hallelujah. What are you doing with generational wealth? That man is not thinking about any generation. And many of them like that. You know, imagine how many lives that money has saved. If he had kept it, piling it up for generations to come, you wonder what God will do to him when he gets to eternity. Maybe I get maybe a special cell. There be a bar. Then one demon will be taking $1 to eat. All that money you packed. Yeah. You know, that's why the rich man was begging Abraham, let me go back and warn the people I left. Abraham said, no way. They have the prophets and the law to guide them. No way. Most important thing is don't have any value. Amen? It's neither there nor there. And you know what? When you take your mind away from this, the Bible says, seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and whatsoever you need shall be what? Made available. God will make available what you need. Hallelujah. Because you don't know what you need. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Only God knows what you need. Now, no matter how difficult things may be for you, you should always have it in mind to tell God, you know what? I don't ever want what I don't need. Don't give me the money that I don't need. How many people can pray that prayer? Somebody's laughing. Don't give me the money that I don't need. When you can't even see 3 square meals a day, you are praying and asking God not to give you the money you don't need. That means you have a good understanding. Some people, you tell them, it's vanity upon vanity. You say, hey, we know. Solomon experienced his own and declared vanity. Let me experience my own, and then I can write that it is vanity. Because it would not be right. That's what Solomon experienced and wrote his own. I need to also experience my own, so I can write and let the world know that it is vanity upon vanity. Hallelujah. Whatever, you don't need it. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And so you see that once you understand what God is talking about, once you understand what God is saying, then you can also begin to experience freedom. Hallelujah. Like I always tell us, God has already taken care of all we would ever need in life. Amen. God has already taken care of it. What we need is to be delivered from the elements of the world. Because these things are the things that are enslaving us. They are the things that are enslaving us. So we need to be delivered from them. Praise the Lord. Let's quickly go to Ephesians chapter 2. And I think that's where we're going to round up tonight. Ephesians chapter 2. We read from verse 1. It said, "And you had he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sin, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now walketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we had our conversation in times past, in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and we are by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace you are saved, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places." Beautiful. He said, "And you had he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sin." I'm just praying that really what the Lord has done for us, that we can see that we are really benefiting from it. And that work that he did is not in vain. That work is not in vain. He said, "Wherein in time past you worked according to the course of this world." In time past, you worked according to the course of this world. So you now know where the making it came from. Huh? This is where it came from. "According to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience." The cause of this world. So the world has a cause that it is running on. That's the cause of making it. Be all you can be and get all you can get. The cause of this world. According to there's a prince that has been assigned to that, that's been given that assignment. It's a prince. So everybody is doing everything to make. And you know the reason why, you know, that is happening, so that nobody will be interested in erecting the holy temple of God. Because you cannot be seeking to make it and be able to make any meaningful contribution towards the erection of the kingdom of God. Can you see where the devil? There's nobody who is seeking to make it, who is seeking to be all he can be and get all he can get, who will be able to make the supply that is needed in the kingdom. You will not be able to do it. Are you hearing what I'm saying? That's why he said you cannot serve God and mammon. You can't. He said, if you will lose your life for my sake, you will gain it. But if you try to gain your life, you will lose it. So in the kingdom of God, you don't gain your life. Because what happens, he said, a man went out to search for treasure. And then when he found it, what did he do? The Bible said he went and sold all that he had.
Say, someone who has found the treasure cannot be seeking to make it or to be all he can be and get all he can get. He said, if when you have found that treasure, you don't try to gain your life again. That life is gone. According to the former conversation, that's a former conversation of be all you can be and get all you can get. It's a former conversation that is according to the world. Yeah? Is according to the world, the course of this world, that is being supervised by the prince of the power of the air. So what do you think is happening in the churches?
Yes.
He's in charge. The prince of the power of the air is the one that is in charge in the prosperity breakthrough churches, not God. Because they are running according to the course of the world. They are not interested in the kingdom. In establishing a habitation for God. No, they are interested in their own making it and being all they can be and getting all they can get. Somebody told me the other day, he said that they bled blood. They bled blood in sowing. In that church, when you are coming, you come with your checkbook. Maybe we'll start it here one sometime. Is it a bad thing to come with your checkbook? It's not a bad thing. It's here that you now know it's a bad thing. You didn't know before. Eh? Is it there they come with a checkbook? Is it not you want to make it now? Making it is it by is not in this kingdom, prosperity does not answer to prayer, it answers to giving. So you can see who is working. The prince of the power of the earth. So what they are doing is according to the course of this world. So he's the one that is in charge. Collecting all the tithes, all the seed, prophet offering, lamb offering, first fruit. The prince of the power of the earth. Bible said these were the things we had our conversations in the past. But unfortunately, for some, it's not in the past. They don't even know about this habitation of God. They are not even interested about this habitation. They are not even making any effort about this habitation. They are not interested because they feel that, you know, they can, they, you know, that of course, yeah, this is God walking. And of course, they don't even have any understanding of where God is coming from. Why God is saying, love not the world, nor the things in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. It took the Holy Spirit for me to understand, because each time the word of God is speaking to me, I know that it's a lot deeper than what one is speaking from the surface. The word of God is never speaking on the surface. It's much, much deeper. There must be a reason why God is saying, love not the world or the things in the world. You need to come from where God is coming from so you can appreciate why he's, because he's not asking, it's not religion, it's not works, he's not trying to get you to do something. There's a reason why he is saying it. There's a reason why he asked Adam and Eve not to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Of course, we can all see the mess that we are in today. That's a consequence of eating that knowledge of good. So God is all wise when he says, don't do this. There's a reason. Even if he's asking you to do something, there's a reason. And when you understand what is the reasoning behind his instruction, it empowers you to live the way that God is living. Hallelujah. Because you know better. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Just like what we've been sharing tonight, that is deliverance. When you're talking about deliverance, that's what deliverance, that if you understand it, suddenly the weight that the prince of the power of this world has placed upon your shoulders will just be lifted. Might just set the allegation, high jump. He just tetola. I say, get my mama. And you wouldn't even ask, why am I even jumping? I jump with high. Make it. Because make it. What next? And I just now jump. And I make it. And you go, and make it. Gin emezie from the. No, there are, you say, wisdom crieth in the streets. Your mind, you have to constantly engage your mind. Don't just be doing things for the sake of doing it. You need to be asking yourself, why am I doing this thing? It doesn't make sense. Find out. Let it make sense. You mustn't go to work
Well, why must it be every morning you wake up, I'm rushing to work? Ask yourself one day, why must I be rushing to this, my workplace? Are you sure I'm not selling myself short doing this? Until the Holy Spirit can speak to your heart to make you understand why you have to wake up every morning and be rushing. You know, until you discover, then you will be doing it with purpose and understanding. Because if you're just doing it for the sake of doing it, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. I don't have to do it because others are doing it. I want to know why I must do it. I want to know. If it doesn't make sense, then I'm not going to do it. Doesn't matter what it's going to cost me. It must make sense. And I must get it right. If I don't get it, that's the truth. And that's why, like, sometimes you find out that, you know, before you do anything, you will struggle. Your mind will be processing and processing and processing and processing. And the moment it feels right, the moment the peace comes, you set yourself. You know that whatever you're doing, that God is the one behind it. Hallelujah. And then you can do it with all confidence. And you don't need to, whatever you are doing, and Holy Ghost, you're praying. Hey, make it happen. Make it happen. Make it happen. God knows that. I'm telling you the truth. He said, you want to use scripture? He said in your word, Father God, anything we want to do, let us commit it before you, and then you will do what? You know the scriptures, I don't know it very well. When you commit your ways unto the Lord, so Father, we are committing it into your hands so that you will now direct us. It's a lie. It's a lie. You already know what you are looking for before you started that thing. This one, you just want to bribe God so that you can get God into the matter. Anything you have to do that while you're down, if your heart is pure, clean, whatever, you don't need prayer. Don't. Prayer is for other things. We've talked about the window of supply. Huh? That's what prayer is for. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Prayer is not for that thing that you are doing. If whatever you are doing is sanctioned by God, Bible says they that are led by the Spirit are the sons of God. So if the Spirit is already leading you, can you except the Spirit is not leading you, and you are not sure that the Spirit is leading you, so you are now praying to force the Spirit to now be in the process. But if the Spirit is already in the process, you'll just be going your way because he's the one directing you. Hallelujah. You don't need prayer. You don't need to force the thing through. Eh? If it's God, he will make it happen. Are you getting what I'm saying? If it is God, he will make it happen. If he doesn't make it happen, then it is not God. Praise the Lord. Is somebody getting me tonight? Hallelujah. Please, prayer should be for what? Window of supply. We've talked about that. All these enyemaka prayer, not the work. Amen. Stop being desperate. Relax. Nothing mega. No shaking. Huh? Nothing mega. Relax. Praise the Lord. I want you to know that any opportunity God gives you, you know, is an opportunity for you to prove your faithfulness. Are you hearing what I'm saying? It's an opportunity for God for you to prove. You know, I tell people, the problem a rich man will always have is, how does he prove his faithfulness to God? That's the dilemma of a rich man. But many of you don't know. How does a rich man prove his faithfulness to God? Can somebody tell me? His time? Tithe? Who can help me? How can a rich man prove his faithfulness to God? You said it all. Jesus said, remember, he's the master. And remember, he doesn't just say things ordinarily. The master said, it is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. You know, a lot of people look at it from the shallow level. Oh, it doesn't really mean, you know. Now, that's the master speaking. Now, what he's telling you is that because you are a rich man, your path to the kingdom even without the riches, your path to the kingdom is already very difficult. But now with the riches, you have made it even more difficult. you have made it even more difficult. He said, how hardly shall a rich man enter the kingdom? That's the problem. The poor man does not know that he is blessed. He looks as the rich man, as the one who is blessed. You know why? Because why Jesus is saying it is easier is because for a poor man, if a poor man can overlook his circumstances and whatever that is around him, that is torturing him, that is affecting his life or making him feel bad, if he can overlook all those things and worship God in spirit and in truth for who he is, not mind, that's why the worship of Lazarus could not be touched by anything. Why? Because this was a man who had sores all over his body and had dogs licking the sores, who was eating from the crumbs that were coming out from the rich man's table. And yet he remained a lover of God, a worshiper of God. Those things never affected him even for 1 second in his relationship with God. So it was not difficult for him. That's the difference. It's not difficult for a poor man to prove his faithfulness to God. Because if he can worship God without all those things, attachment, God knows that the worship is what? Real. But for the rich man, it will be difficult. Why? I give you an example. Job. When God told the devil, he said, consider my servant Job. He said, there is no man like him who loves me the way he loves me. The devil laughed. He said, who would not love you with the things you have given him? And he's spot on. Do you know that? He is spot on. If he wasn't spot on, God wouldn't give him the license to go and take away those things. Yes, he was spot on. That was why God gave him the license to go and take out those things. And when he did, Job confirmed the faith that God put in him. The wife came to him and said, nah, it was granny horse. And Job said, though he slay me, I will yet trust him. So the only way the rich man can prove to God that he loves him is by having that mindset. He brought, he takes. I have nothing. In other words, he does not have any value or attachment to any of the things that he has. In which case, again, I ask, then what is the point of having it? Now, the most important thing is for you to understand that, because like I said, if you wouldn't have value for it, why do you need it? Now, this is where the Spirit of God comes in. That's why the Bible says, they that are led by the Spirit are so, okay? That also will answer your own question, okay? Now, if in doing something and you have a staff system, all the things, you know, where the things work, all that, now, it's not a problem as long as the Spirit is in. Are you getting what I'm saying? Now, the problem is when the Spirit is not here. If the Spirit is behind it, then the Spirit will guide you in whatever that you are doing, whatever is the outcome, whatever is the inflow, whatever is the outlook, the Spirit will be there to guide and lead you. Are you getting what I'm saying? Now, in summary of all the questions we are asking, and we are bothering ourselves like this, that's why he said, they that are led by the Spirit are the son of. Even if you have a system that you are running, all you need to do is to find out whether it is the system that is now running you. Are you getting what I'm saying? Or you running the system. How will you know if the system is running you? By allowing the Holy Spirit take over your life. Are you getting what I'm saying? And if the Holy Spirit takes over your life, and then a situation where the Holy Spirit is saying, you wake up in the morning, the Spirit says, you know what? I need it. Hang in there, but the system is calling. You are now turned into two. Whether you will stay with the Spirit or whether you are going to answer the system. Now, the choice you make at that point determines what kind of effect the system now has on you. Whether the system has become God to you. Are you getting what I'm saying? But if at that time, the Holy Spirit says, you know what? I need you. And you say, the system, you know what? You can go to hell. You are in charge. Are you getting what I'm saying? But if you cannot tell that system to go to hell, you have a problem. You have a problem. That means that system is running you. That system has taken over your life. Are you getting what I'm saying? But if the Spirit, that's why we need the Spirit in our lives. That's where the Holy Spirit helps us. Okay? Now, a situation where, like the rich man, that man that whose ground brought forth the plenty, he was on his own. And the ground brought forth the plaintiff, and then his flesh took over, and he started thinking of how he was going to spend all his days in comfort. Of course, he was not working with the Holy Spirit, okay? But if he was working with the Spirit would have told him what to do with the ground that brought forth plentifully. He would have said, Bulo Fumba Bunalo, Pastor Victor, Bulo Fumba Bunalo, Aquila, Bukwalo Fu. And by the time he distributes it, Bible said, a in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, he said the church ran with this format, that they that had abundance brought in their abundance, so they that lacked had no lack, and there was equality in the church. Are you getting it? That's how it works. So if the Spirit is allowing excess in your hands, just walk with the Spirit to know. Don't become selfish. That's the problem. The moment you know, that's why we are talking about, you know, and of course, if this love that we are talking about begins to show forth in us, then even we won't have any problem. If we are hearing these things, we'll just be smiling. Are you getting what I'm saying? Because why? Love has taken over your heart, and you can't be caught up in that trap. Are you getting what I'm saying? So that's why he said, they that are led by the Spirit are the sons of God. So it's not a problem. It's not a problem. The only problem that the rich man had was that already God saw that the riches had taken over his life. Now, because he was in a miserable state, the riches had taken over, obviously taken over his life. So Jesus now said, you know what you're going to do? Just go and sell it and give to the poor. The reason why I started saying this is such that whatever situation you find yourself, just know that it's an opportunity for you to prove your faithfulness. Are you hearing what I'm saying? If you're going through challenges, if you're going through stuff, no money in the pocket, difficulty in, you know, sorting out things, don't start feeling, I'm suffering or I'm doing. No. Stop feeling that. God is giving you an opportunity to prove your faithfulness, because that's the best time you can prove to God that you love Him. Not when you have things. It's difficult. When you prove yourself, when you don't have, then you will not need to prove when you have. Are you getting what I'm saying? Because God, you've already walked with Him when you didn't have. So He will never be bothered, because He knows where your heart is. That was the same thing with Job. And that was why he was boasting, but the devil didn't understand. And he said, okay, let me prove it to you. Okay? And you know, like you talked about Abraham. That was also the same thing with Abraham. But Abraham, along the line, he started running the course of the world. And started accumulating wealth that God didn't ask him to accumulate. He was accumulating wealth all over the place that God didn't ask. God never asked him to accumulate that wealth. You know, like some Christians will say, Abraham's blessings are mine. Abraham's blessings are mine. I am rich. How do you sing it? In the morning, blessing. Abraham is the rich, the gold and silver. But you know what God told him when he came back with all that gold and silver? God called him and said, Abraham, I am your exceeding great reward. You don't need that money you accumulated. I am everything. And as a matter of fact, that's actually what it is. Are you getting what I'm saying? You know, that's even why God will be jealous. Because a rich man, God will now be struggling in your heart with your riches. He doesn't want to struggle. He wants you to know that He is your riches. Are you getting what I'm saying? He, God, is your riches. You don't need to accumulate anything. At any time you need anything, that's why you have the Spirit. The Spirit will make it available. I said this thing one time, and I'm not sure many of us gave a lot of thought to it. I said, any believer who is rich in God is richer than Dangote, richer than Bill Gates, richer than what's the newest man, the richest newest man. You seem to know all of them. You are researching. She seems to know all of them. Okay. But the truth of the matter is that you are richer. That's the truth. Go and sleep on it. You are richer. But just that you don't know. Any man, woman that is rich in God is richer than the richest man in this world. That's how important the Holy... That's why when I talk about being filled with the Holy Spirit, you may not understand. And I wonder, how do we move about as Christians? How do we even feel? How do you even feel not being filled with the Holy Spirit? How do you even feel? How confident are you to just be strolling and moving around, not being sure that you are filled with the Holy Spirit and that the Holy Spirit is the one leading you? We need to do better. Stand up on your feet.